Welcome, friends, to another edition of Tiffin Box TV. I'm your host, Seishu, and I'm so thrilled to have Peter Hurley with me today. Peter is a photographer, we all know that, but he's also an author, a teacher, and a speaker. And I am so excited to have him here because, well, I'm a huge fan, but I've also been studying with him, studying under his guidance, watching his videos, which are hilarious, right? And they are so instructive, too. I also credit Peter for really kickstarting my headshot business. You know, if you have a photography business and you are ever experiencing a lull, there's nothing better than really just saying, hey, who needs a headshot? And there are out there, there are people out there who are absolutely, absolutely in need of one. Trust me. Thanks for joining us today, Peter.
Thanks for having me on, Seishu. I'm glad that we got to do this.
Excellent. You know, I'm going to jump right in, man. You know, you are one busy dude. You have a website, you teach people, you write books. You have a website dedicated just for products that you're starting to sell now too, called Hurley Pro. How do you do it all with a family as well?
I mean, that's a really good question. It's not easy. I guess it's just in my blood to be a workhorse. I have a really difficult time with downtime, and my wife knows that, so she's ultra supportive. I could have never done anything that I've done without her being behind me 100%. So she allows me to, do what I need to do. I mean, writing this book was crazy. I really have to credit her because I would shoot all day in the studio, mm-hmm. be pretty much exhausted, go home. I live two blocks away. I'd go home, I'd have dinner. I'd come back to the studio and work past midnight. Usually I'd go back home around 1 or 2 in the morning between January and June when I really had to get this thing done. I had been a little bit sluggish on it, and it just wasn't going anywhere, and the publishers kept telling me, we got to get this book out. And I was like, I really have to settle in and do it. And without the family support, it would have never gotten done. So I think that's where it starts. I married the right one.
There you
She's
go.
Amazing.
That sounds great. Yeah. I mean, I have to also credit my wife for supporting my crazy lifestyle and my ambitions as well. So I think we've got that in common. Let's dial it down a bit and ask you a little bit about your background. I know you started out as a model, right?
Yeah.
You were a model for a number of years, and you've jumped from being a model to being a photographer, and that jump didn't take place overnight. It took some amount of time. What or who inspired you to even say, okay, well, photography is an option for me now?
Well, you know, I never thought I'd be a photographer. I just hung out with a lot of photographers, and I became friends with a lot of photographers, and I thought they were cool, and I thought they've got a cool lifestyle. But I never saw myself as an artist, and I knew nothing about photography, so I just didn't. It wasn't in the cards for me at that time. And then what really spurred it was I enjoyed doing a lot of different shoots, and I was, since I was modeling, I would get the opportunity to spend time on sets. And, you know, I kicked myself now. Once I decided to pick up a camera, I became the most annoying model on the set and tried to soak up as much information as possible. But for like 5 years, I was of my modeling, I was not paying any attention to anyone or anything. I was just like, you know, I'd go shoot and then go do my thing or hang out or whatever. And I'm kicking myself now, trying to reach back into my memory banks to what actually went on those shoots. I worked with some amazing photographers. So I was sailing, training for the Olympics. I raced sailboats. And then I met a designer from Donna Karen, and I got sponsored by DKNY. And then she called me one day and she's like, I have a friend who knows a designer at Polo and they're looking for sailors to do an ad campaign. Can you go meet this guy in Manhattan? And I was like, I'm from the Jersey Shore. So I was like, yeah, I'll go. So I went and came into the city, met this guy, and he sent me over to this art director. I met the art director. That designer and that art director are both incredible photographers now, which is kind of funny that I am too. The three of us, like, they were doing other things and they picked up cameras. But anyway, I got the job, and the photographer on the job was Bruce Weber. Bruce and I became friends, and he was a big inspiration to me. I mean, I spent a lot of time with him. I never thought I'd pick up a camera, and he encouraged me to do it. Without his encouragement, it would have never happened. So I really, to this day, I've always thanked him. He's my mentor. He's my biggest inspiration, and I just love his work and what he does. And spending a lot of time with him was like a major bonus. I mean, I never got any specifics out of it. He didn't say, okay, put your aperture and your shutter speed and do this. It wasn't like that. It was just hanging out, and he would look at my pictures and be supportive and stuff. I'm pretty much all self-taught, but having him to bounce ideas off of was pretty powerful at the beginning of my career. I got my first commercial job, and I was freaking out, and I called him. And he's like, you're going to be fine. Just do it. You're going to be good. And I did great. And I got, but I was a little freaked out at the beginning.
One of the things I think that amazes me about photographers, at least who've reached some notoriety, I guess, in the industry, is that they tend to do things rather easily. I mean, at least it seems easy, but it's not easy, is it? You've always had to perhaps practice and do things again and again and again in different ways, and really grow from the kinds of mistakes that you've made. Can you talk a little bit about perhaps one blunder that caused you the greatest inspiration to be a better photographer?
I don't know if it was a blunder, but there was a fear that held me back. I think a lot of photographers fall into this. When I started, I didn't know anything about light. I knew I was working with, I was fortunate. I became an annoying model on the set, but I was fortunate that I was still modeling at the beginning of my photography career, because I started to ask questions. I started to be very visual. I started to watch. And I don't know if that helped me or hurt me, because what it would do, I'd be on different sets all the time. I'd be like, oh, I got to buy that. Wait, that now I got to get one of those.
Right.
That guy's using this. This is going to be great. So I have all this stuff in my closet that I bought because one photographer used it on me, and I thought it was cool, and I used it like for a day, and I don't know. But I think the thing was, I was scared of light. I was unsure. I was self-taught, and I always used natural light, so I was really good with natural light. I felt good with natural light. I felt comfortable with natural light. The minute I had to light somebody, I didn't know what I was doing. I even saw, my first studio was attached to a big studio, and I saw all these major photographers working, and I would tell the studio manager, when you go in there, write the setup, like write exactly what they did. And I would go in there and walk around and act like I had to go get something in the kitchen or something like that, and kind of look, or if they kept it overnight, I would go sneak in and see what their setup was. But it didn't help me with my awareness to light. I didn't know their settings. I didn't know, not that that would have mattered. I mean, I didn't really know light well enough. So I got a job. I was petrified. I got this job, and I was on The Apprentice. So Donald Trump it was like the second season, and they were doing something with Levi's, and they needed some photographers. So somebody caught wind of the job, the woman who ran the studio where I was said, hey, do you want to do this thing? Do you want to go on The Apprentice? And I was like, yeah, that sounds awesome. Let's go. Well, it was an ad campaign they were supposed to do an ad for Levi's. And I didn't know how to light anything. I was like, I don't know. I'm like freaked out, petrified. So I called, I had one assistant who was really great at lighting, who had worked with me in the past. And I called him, and I was like, he was more of a friend who basically said he would go out of his way and help assist me to teach me a little bit. And he set up the lighting on that shoot, and it looked great. And it was amazing. And I was like, these pictures are awesome. And the light was great, and the makeup artist they brought in was great, and the models they brought in was great, and the shoot went really well. I was on The Apprentice. It was cool. And everybody thought I was a complete stud. And then they didn't know that in the back of my brain, I didn't know what the hell I was doing. I didn't know how to light that. I would have never lit it. I would have never been able to light that back then. Now I could light it. Now I could have done it in my sleep pretty much. But back then, I was clueless. So I think over the years, it's awareness to light and its subtleties. It's like figuring out the subtleties of what goes on, when, like, why are you using one modifier over the next?
Right.
Why are you powering things a certain way? Why? How many heads are you hitting the people with? Why are you using all those heads? Like, that kind of stuff, it's a process that you have to go through. And I think it's you know, opening my eyes to light. Now, I did a DVD, a tutorial with F-stoppers called Illuminating the Face.
Right.
And I learned a lot doing that, because when a lot of times you're doing things and you do it by routine, you know, it's habit. You understand your light. I know what I want. Whenever I'm working with a new assistant, I'm always like, I got to teach them kind of what I'm doing. But when you have to teach it to other people that aren't in the room, like it's like, and the guys at F-stoppers are so good at this, at coaching me and getting me to go, well, okay, but what if we were really clueless? Like, what would we? And I'm like, you have to say it like this. And I was like, really? So I actually learned more about what I knew about lighting through that. And I learned what I didn't know. It was great.
Fantastic. That's
but
great.
For me, it's all about awareness, and photography is about light. So light's really important.
One of the people that really taught me a great deal about light was Zach Arias. I know Zach is a friend of yours as well, and perhaps was instrumental in guiding you or prompting you to go the way of teaching your style of photography to other people. When it comes down to people like Zach in the industry, it's, you know, who does his own thing with light and has a great number of people as well as in terms of followers and things like that. Do you feel that your social media followers are somewhat, you know, in a way they're the same people that follow him as well as you? I mean, do you have different followers?
I think we have different followers. I mean, I think if you're out there searching for knowledge, you're going to come across teachers that you resonate with. You know, I think he has more. I'm pretty pleased with the following that I've built for myself, and the people that pop out of the woodwork and want to do headshot photography and stuff. I think it's awesome. But I think if you're searching around there, you're going to stumble across me. You're going to stumble across him. You're going to stumble across Jeremy Carrot. You're going to stumble across, you know, Lindsay Adler or whatever. All of us are out there and we're teaching the circuit and stuff. And hopefully people soak up that knowledge and then pick, you know, who they feel they want to work with or learn from or resonate with, you know, depending on where they are. I mean, if people are shooting headshots, they're obviously going to resonate with me. And that might be like, you know, did you obviously learn that from Zach? I knew that, you know, people will go on I have the headshot crew and they'll talk about Zach in the comments and stuff at times. So it's nice, especially because Zach's been a big influence to me, because he, first, I love the guy, and he's an amazing guy, but he was the one that got me to teach. He was the one that sat me down and goes, look, he said to me, this was in 2010 at PPE, we met through the F-stoppers who introduced us. They were having a little get-together, and Zach was like, he goes, you're the headshot guy. I was like, yeah. Mm-hmm. He goes, you know, I was looking to do a headshot. I want to find out some information, and all roads led to you. You should teach. Oh, I was like, really?
That's
I don't
awesome.
Teach? I was like, I wouldn't know what to teach. I was like, he's like, just start doing it. Like, get on Twitter and get on this and do that. I opened a Twitter account, I guess, right before that. And he's like, you got to do a tutorial, do a class, do a workshop. I took him out to lunch and we brainstormed this. And after that, I was off to the races. So
Fantastic.
It was really him that, like, it was like the turning point was just, you know, and having somebody like that who had been successful at it, you know, tell me to do it is really cool. And I had no idea that I was going to love it so much or really enjoy. I enjoy it. I like seeing photographers be successful through, and I like seeing that where they've come, where they started, and then where they went at with the information that I put out there. Cause it's rewarding for me, but it's even better for them. Like, whenever I get texts and emails and calls with people saying, hey, I just got this job. I got this job. I got that job. And a lot of people are getting referrals through the headshot crew, and I'm like, and I taught you how to do this, so now you can make a living for your family and stuff. It's amazing.
That's right.
It's so
That's
cool.
Right. Let's talk a little bit about the headshot crew. I think you call it the world's largest team of headshot and portrait photographers, and you've got 6,000 photographers in this group. Is that?
There's 9,000.
9,000 now. Where?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I've got to get my research is definitely old. But tell me a little bit about how that came about. I mean, why did you decide this is something you needed to do or wanted to do in terms of nurturing other photographers?
Well, it really didn't start as a it was a twofold attempt. I had come up with the concept. I had called it as something else. I called it, this is what happened. I am expensive. Like, for people to come in and get a headshot from me, it's over $1,000. So people would call the studio and they'd be like, hey, I need a headshot. And I'd be like, okay, great. It's $1,000. Click. Mm. And I'd be like, they're gone, but they need that service. So I was like, how can I figure out a way to do a lower price package for that person that might want that? And then, so now we have a headshot crew, associate photographers that shoot out of my studio. So a person comes up, hey, how much is a headshot? Well, we got a couple options. You could shoot with Peter for $1,200. That's what I charge for my smallest session. Or you can shoot with the associate photographer for $400. So it's a third the price, and we don't get the click anymore. And then we get that person a decent headshot with somebody that was coached by me. So that started in 2007. I brought in the first photographer to work with me. And I know a lot of other photographers have this business. I'm sure there's a lot of wedding photographers who have teams of people working for them so they could shoot multiple things. But it's really a great way to generate income for the studio. And what happened was I needed a platform for my coaching. And at the same time, I was like, wait, if I'm doing it in New York, why can't I do it all over the place? Like, if somebody's associated with me, why can't I put my stamp of approval to them? And if somebody looking around in their town for a headshot photographer, they're going to say, hey, he's attached to this guy who's really good in New York and his work's really good and he gets coached by this guy, and let me shoot there. So that's what we did. So we created this site, and back then we called it PH2. And then I was like, PH2.com isn't available. And then I found PH2 Pro. I was like, everything's pro. So we had Hurley Pro, we had PH2 Pro. I was like, everything's pro, just go pro. But then I was like, people don't know what that means. I was like, that's not cool. And it's a really good group. And it's a bunch of photographers that are all kind of focused on similar goals. And so I was in, a year ago, I was in Hong Kong. And I was sitting in an airport. I was with Jason Crew from WPPI and PDN and my web designer. I was like, we need a new name for this. What do you guys think of Headshot Crew? And they were like, it's cool. I was like, done. Boom. Nice. So we did it. We did a rebrand January 1st of last year. And now people could take a 30-day free trial and get in and check it out. And then it's $19.99 a month after that. And we have associate photographers all over the world. This past week, I just got a new one in Oslo, Norway, Christopher Sandvin. Is there, and it's just nice to be able to say to a lot of the companies that I work with, they have offices all over. I say, hey, you like my work? I have a guy in blah 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 that could do it for you. We've got pretty much, we're trying to get every major city in the world covered. I just got Budapest, Hungary. Ballast Toth is over there doing that. I've got photographers in London, Dubai. We've got I've got one in Perth, Australia.
Oh, that's Bruno. Bruno was instrumental in getting me to talk to you today, actually. So, hat tip to him.
Yeah, yeah.
So, one of the things you do as well is a website called Sci-Photology. What is that? What exactly is Sci-Photology?
Sci-Photology is essentially, if I was going to explain it, I mean, the way that I explain it is, and every photographer listening knows this, when people get in front of the camera, they get weird. I mean, they just get strange.
I think both photographers and subjects get weird too, right?
Yeah, well, I don't know. I hope if you're a photographer, you're not getting too weird. Or at least you got to get that under control so you have your shtick down.
That's right.
But what happens is, and I did a TEDx talk on this, which I'm really proud of. I mean, to go, and that came through another photographer. Rick Byrne had a friend who was in charge of a TEDx speaking at MIT, and she saw my Squinch video and asked him if he knew me. And he's like, yeah, I know him. Like, will you ask him to do a TEDx talk? And he's like, sure. And I said we should do it on Sci-Photology. So if you haven't seen that, it's called Bridging the Self-Acceptance Gap. And really what it is that, you know, we are embodied in whatever we're given at birth. Like, our parents were born, and then we have this capsule that we walk around in. Mm. And how we see ourselves could be similar to the way other people see us, but it could be completely the opposite. And I think the hardest thing for a portrait photographer is when somebody comes in and they don't see themselves the way that you do. And it happens every day, and you've all dealt with it. I know you have. You know, somebody comes in. I had multiple people this week. Oh no, I don't. I can't look at myself. Don't. Oh my gosh, I got to get at it. I can't stand taking my picture. You know.
Right. Right.
And then you have somebody come in who's just like, oh my gosh, I look so great. That's the best picture ever taken of me. This. Let me get back in there. I can't wait. This is awesome. Mm-hmm. Like, what's the difference between those two people? Like, what happened? Like, why is that happening in our society where some people just? I mean, they have to walk around in that body. You know, their face has been on their face since they've been born.
Right.
Why not embrace it? You know, what are they embracing? And what is, you know, this whole concept of beauty? For me, beauty and how attractive people are is totally, it's so much based on how they feel about themselves.
Yeah.
It's people who come in here and might not be attractive to other people's standards, look at their picture and are like, oh my gosh, that's the best picture of me I've ever seen. I'm melting. You know, I'm like, this person's awesome. And I see the beauty in them. I'm pulling it out. So I'm getting these and I find it. And I think that for anybody listening, that's our job. Like, how can you make every single person? I get this a lot. Like, oh my, I had this one guy wrote me an email and he goes, I need help. I have a girl coming in. And she's got a horse face. And I've never shot anybody with a horse face. And I don't know what to do.
Wow.
And I was like, I don't know anybody with a horse. I've never seen a horse face either. I don't know. I wouldn't know what to do with a horse face either. And then he sent me pictures of her. And she was gorgeous. I was like, where are you coming up with this?
Yeah, wow.
And prior to the shoot, that something's wrong with her. I mean.
Yeah, that's sad.
First of all, it's there's the beauty. Beauty's always there. It's our job to find it. And our bar is that person's best picture. Like the best picture that person's ever had of themselves is our bar. Go beat it.
Mm.
I know everybody coming in that door doesn't have a Peter Hurley headshot. And I mean, I may be working against age or whatever, but I'm going to do the best I can at that moment with them. And this is all the psychological stuff that goes through. So I've been working with Dr. Anna Rowley on this cytology thing, and we got a big thing going here. I mean, it's a major idea. It's a new discipline in the way we can mesh psychology and use the photography as a tool for people to have, you know, to gain self-awareness about themselves and a little bit more understanding so that they can walk around in this capsule that we've been given and be proud of it.
Indeed. So how would photographers perhaps sign up and get something out of this new option that you're offering?
Well, what we're doing is we're starting to train. We are a photographer psychologist team.
Okay.
And we go into companies and we work with leadership teams and stuff like that. And we work with individuals as well. So if people want to come to us, we will put them through our process and kind of give them the gist of we have a whole thing. We also do team building stuff, which is really cool. It's so much fun. I really want to like dedicate a lot of my time to this. In 2016, I'm going full bore towards the cytology stuff. But what I'm looking for are photographers, and we're starting to mesh photographers, pair photographers up with psychologists so that they can kind of start working together. And I'm going to start doing a training on the cytology aspects of it. It's very different having a cytology a shoot that is involved in the cytology process because the person coming in is more aware of that. I won't tell somebody who comes in here and is like, I can't stand my face, you know, things that I'll say when they're in the cytology process. I'll be like, well, tell me about that. You know, I mean, I'm not going to say that to a paying client that I just need to get a good headshot of that needs it for personal branding if they're not open to that. But
sure.
Once you've opened up the door that you're coming in to work with a psychologist, it opens up. I mean, it's a totally different experience and it's really cool. So we're looking for photographers that can obviously good portraitists that can take, you know, great pictures of people. I don't want the technique to get in the way of that's the other thing is if you're taking mediocre pictures and the person looks at it, it's a lot different than if you know you're taking great pictures.
Sure.
And the person looks at it and it's more negative. There's something going on and for me, cytology is really about coaching the inner critic so that that person's inner critic becomes their inner coach. So the inner critic is saying, oh, my nose is too big, my face is too wide, that zit is huge.
Right.
And our job as photographers is to get that voice to say, hey, that shot looks pretty good. Oh my gosh, Peter knows what he's talking about. This is the best picture. This is the best photo shoot of my life. Wait, let me do everything he says. I'll squinch a little bit. I'll get my chin out. I'm going to relax. I got it. I'm doing this, that, and the other thing. And then they get the best pictures that they've ever had. Mm-hmm. And they understand it because what you did was you shifted their exactly. their perception right. mid-shoot. So that's a tool,
yes.
you know.
Yes, I'm personally very excited about learning more about it. And hopefully we will connect about it after this show. One last question. Christmas is right around the corner, and you've got a wonderful shop called Hurley Pro. You've got lots of goodies in there, man. Tell us one thing or maybe two things that you're really excited about for this season.
I wish I had more. I keep coming up with concepts of stuff.
I know.
And products are tough. I mean, it takes from design to implementation to get it in your possession. I have, I'll show you real quick. I have so here's two of my favorite products that I have going. So I designed a flex kit with Westcott, and these lights are amazing. This changed my, I mean, I've been shooting continuous light since 2004, but I could never take it out of the studio. Now with all the traveling I'm doing because of the shift in the headshot business and sci photology, I now can take these things everywhere I go. So these are on HurleyProGear.com. You can get them there, and it's $5,500 for the kit. And it's been amazing. And they're flying off the shelves, and it's hard for, so we're trying to build up stock. They just came out, so we're trying to get everything out the door before the holidays so people can get a hold of them. But one of my favorite things is this. This is a eight Hurley Pro H2 Pro bag. How many people carry sandbags around? You know, you carry sandbags everywhere you go. I need sandbags. So the thing I loathe the most to take out of the studio is a sandbag with me. So I developed a bag, and it's water ballast. So it's just, it's got, you know, I fill it up with water when I get to the shoot. And then I'm there, and boom, shakalaka, I'm in business, and I got my water ballast. So, it's just lugging around stuff. Just I can fly anywhere and take these, and I don't have to worry about renting sandbags or dealing with any of that. And
How many pounds is that?
10 pounds.
10 pounds, okay.
So, and they zip together. So if you have two of, hey, Brittany, grab me another one because I got my earphones in. They zip together to be more like a traditional sandbag to go over the leg of a stand, or you can hang them from a stand like this.
Awesome.
I'll show you the little. And then the other thing I have in there is my Hurley Pro Pro Board, which is a background that I've been selling for a couple years, which I take everywhere with me, and I check it on planes, no problem. And I love it because I don't take white seamless paper with me anymore. I take my Pro Board. But this is 20 pounds put together.
Awesome.
Of this. Pretty cool. And then the other thing is the book, which we talked about the book.
We talked briefly about the book, but you know, it's something that I'll definitely link to as well. So
I'll show you the book. So the book was 2 years in the making. It was the hardest thing I've ever done. It was like, this was the thing that was going to, you know, it basically knocked the wind out of my sails, and I'm a big sailor, so that's tough to do. But right. this thing, I mean, and when I see, you know, everybody's getting a lot out of it. It's everything that I could possibly think of. I kept jamming more information in it because I keep learning as I go. I became a better photographer because of my teaching. And what happens is I'm always looking for new stuff. As people walk in the door and I shoot them, wait, I was like, wait, I could teach that. So I had to throw it in the book. And then Scott Kelby finally said, he's like, stop doing that. You got to get the book out. You can't just keep doing that. So
there's always the opportunity to write another book, right, Peter?
Oh, I'm not doing that ever again. This is it. You guys, this is the one you get. I don't know. Maybe 10 years from now. That was the hardest thing I've done. So.
Well, Peter, thank you so much for joining us today. Really, it's such a pleasure to be able to, you know, talk about all that you're doing and all you're doing for photographers. Really, you're real inspiration, man.
Thanks, Seju. I appreciate it. Can you do me one favor?
Sure.
All right. I've been sitting here for a half hour looking at your picture on my screen, and there is no squinch. I want you to update that with a squinch, please.
You got it. You know who's really who's really helped me out with a portrait recently. It's Dylan Patrick. I know you know Dylan, right?
Yeah, I know Dylan. I never met him personally, but he seems like a really great guy, and he's doing his
wonderful
own thing
photographer.
Headshot land. He's great. He's
wonderful,
great.
Wonderful guy, wonderful photographer. And he hooked me up with a wonderful portrait that I will be updating to my Skype account. But I can't leave you just without doing this one thing that I've always wanted to do with you, man. Mm-hmm. You know what it is, right?
Do we have to yell something?
Yeah, why not?
Okay. Are we counting down?
We should count down, right?
I always count down, so you count down and then I'll yell it with you.
There you go. 3, 2, 1.
SHABAAM!
I think I blew everybody's ears off. But thanks a lot, brother. Appreciate it.
Me on. I appreciate it.
Take care, man. Bye.
See ya.